Welcome, we'll start with NCERT class 11th economics, the very first chapter that talks about Indian economy on the eve of independence. Now under this book, we would be talking about the development of economics in India and how things have changed over the period. But before understanding that, a kind of historical purview is very, very important because it laid great impact onto the roots of Indian economy when Britishers left India. So what happened actually, what was the economics and what was the things that were happening, what were the things that were happening during the British period form a basis for this lecture. So if you try to understand the developments, we have the kind of world map here and we will try to zoom in and out and understand the developments. So let's say you have India that was here and you had the British Empire that was here. We used to say that the sun of the British Empire never sets because throughout the globe you had the British territories that were established. Now why Britishers were very interested in India? Because during that time India was very rich in agriculture. Then you had numerous handicrafts in the form of small cotton industries, you had textile, you had metalwork that was prevalent here, and most of the raw materials became the source for the future industrial revolution that took place in the European nations. So it was because these European nations were looking forward for an industrial revolution, they required raw material and they could get a cheap raw material from India. Now since India was exhausted of all the raw material, they were not able to meet the local needs. What happened was the finished product was sent from the European nations to India. So ultimately what came into process was India merely became a kind of game where you could say India was a supplier of cheap raw material and an importer of the finished products. So the two things became the key points. First was the importer of raw material and second was basically they were the absorbers or utilizers of the finished products that came as a result of the industrial revolution from Britain. So what happened during the British period was basically a major exploitation of the Indian resources that took place. Now that occurred in agriculture, that occurred in handicraft, and India was during that time known worldwide for the quality production, the fineness in the quality and the standards of craftsmanship during that time. So India was known for Muslin, that was a kind of cotton that came from Dhaka, which is presently in Bangladesh, and you had the finest quality of cotton that was produced from, and that was known as malmal, and the royal people also called it as malmal khas or malmal shahi. Now came the British advent. Britishers, as we said, were interested in India because India was a very good source of raw material for their upcoming industries and the basis for the industrial revolution in Europe. However, there were no efforts that were made to bring about or to raise the national or the per capita income in India. There were numerous efforts that were done by various scholars like Dadabhai Naoroji, William Digby, you have Shirras, Desai and V.K.R.V. Rao. Of these, V.K.R.V. Rao gave the most correct and the accurate, or I could say the significant estimates for the same. The country's growth for the aggregate real output during the first half of the 20th century was less than 2%, and half percent growth was registered in terms of per capita output per year. So the situation was very poor during that time. Now we would understand the British impact on the various fields separately. So we'll first start with agriculture, we'll move on to industry, then foreign trade and so on. So agriculture, 85% of the population was working on agriculture. India was basically an agrarian society and a self-sufficient society because during the 17th century, India was well satisfied or had a self-sufficient agriculture. However, the situation worsened out during the British advent. The things changed because you had the land settlement systems that came into being and you had the revenue settlement that started. So zamindars basically started collecting the rent. Even if the crops were good or not, the economic condition was good or not, the people were forced to pay the rents to the zamindars. If not, the zamindars would lose their zamindari. So zamindars were working hard to collect the revenue by hook or crook. So it hardly or badly affected the farmers in India, and it led to basically the stagnation of agriculture with low productivity. There was low technology, lack of irrigation, and nearly no use of fertilizers. Only few of the people worked forward for commercial cropping system, and that was again for the British use, because we were subserving Britishers for the same, as these cash crops were sent for the British industries. Only few of the farmers could adopt it. So commercialization of industries, or commercialization of agriculture I would say, occurred only for few of the farmers. However, majority of the farmers and the sharecroppers had the situation that was worsened. Coming on to the industries, as we said, the handicraft declined because you had the industries that were coming up, and those British industries were producing the same goods at lower price and importing or bringing in cheap products into the Indian market. So in India, there was no solid modern industrial base that was established. No capital good industry came up into being, and this, the only industries that came up were cotton textile in Maharashtra and Gujarat and jute mills in Bengal, and that also during the second half of the 19th century. The idea of bringing in the industries in India was twofold. So first was to reduce the India to an exporter of raw material, as we said. So India should only be, or should only export raw materials to Britain, and should import the finished products to meet the local needs of the people. So that was a kind of two-way game. As we said, there was no capital good industry that came into being. So no big machine tools were made for future industries to be established or industrialization to be promoted. The growth rate of the industrial sector was very poor, and the contribution to GDP was again very less. Now, there was very limited operations, because most of the operations were governed by public sector, and public sector maintained only few of the things in hand, like that was railways, power generation, communication, ports and telegraphs. So only these services were under public sector, and rest of those were under private. So under private, there was no development that was seen. Now there were some of the books that have been mentioned in this chapter are really good for your references, and so those are Ramesh Chandra Dutt's Economic History of India in 3 volumes, Baden and Powell's The Land Systems of British India in 2 volumes, and Amrithi Sen's book on poverty and famines, which is one of the recent books. Now coming on to the foreign trade, as you can see, the imports and the exports of India were very less before the First World War and during the Second World War. However, after the 1991 reforms, which we call as the LPG reforms, that is liberalization, privatization and globalization, there was a sharp dip, a sharp increase I would say, in the both exports and the imports. Now what the Britishers were trying to do before that, the Britishers were trying to maintain their monopoly on the control of the exports and imports in India. As a result, the purchase and the commodity, purchase of the commodities was more than 50% with the Britishers, and of the remaining trade, only few of the trade occurred with China, Sri Lanka, which was known as Ceylon, and then you had Persia, that was Iran. Again, to ease the trade, Britishers opened up the route from the Swiss Canal, and this opening up of the Swiss Canal reduced the distance, because previously all the ships had to go all the way Africa to reach India, and now through the opening of Swiss Canal, the distance was highly reduced. As a result, the trade became much simpler, the cost game, the cost went further lower, and more of the foreign trade occurred through the Swiss Canal route that opened up or connected port said from Mediterranean to Red Sea. So you have Mediterranean that was connected to Red Sea through the Suez Canal. Now all what was generated was mainly for the export surplus. It was not meant to meet the local needs of the people. So there was no inflow of gold and silver, and whatever money came in was expended only on the luxuries of the British officers in India. So even the basic commodities like food, kerosene and clothes became a scarce commodity for the common man in India. Now looking on to the demography in India, Britishers brought about the idea of census, through which we still have the census in India. The first census was conducted in 1881, and then onwards you have a decadal census every 10 years. In 1881, they revealed the uneven distribution of the population and the uneven growth in the population distribution. Before 1921, India was lying in the first stage of demographic transition model, which showed very high birth rate and high death rate. After 1921, you had the second stage of demographic transition model that was entered. Still, India was facing very low levels of literacy, high infant mortality, high mortality, rampant air and waterborne diseases. Then you had a kind of low life expectancy that was seen. So if we look onto the literacy curve, you have 1900 to 2010, and you can see the literacy was less than 10%, which jumped down to around 80% in the recent years. So that was the state of literacy during the British period in India. Again, the life expectancy was very less, around 44 years in general, which has been increased to 68 years. And so the occupational structure, if we talk about, during the colonial period, 70 to 75% people were engaged in agriculture, only 10% in manufacturing and 15 to 20% in the services. And these services were mainly meant for the British emperors again. Then you had regional variations that existed. Madras Presidency, which includes present-day Tamil Nadu, Andhra Pradesh, Kerala and Karnataka, along with Bombay and Bengal, had good industrial and service sector base because these were lying on the coastal areas and were in more impact or were more affected by the British impact. However, agriculture flourished in the areas of Rajasthan, Punjab and Odisha during that time. Now, if we talk about infrastructure, Britishers brought about lot of infrastructure development in India. It started with railways, roadways, ports, transportation, then you have telegraphs, postal network. Telegraphs were meant for maintaining the law and order, postal services for communication purposes, but all these services were not meant to provide the basic facilities to the common people in India. However, the sole objective for them was to subserve the British rule in India. So, provide Britishers the best facility and the most reasonable things, they developed all these. So, for example, roads. Roads were developed to mobilize the army, to bring in the raw material in and out of the nations through the railways and the major ports. However, the extreme rural areas did not have all weather roads and they were stuck in the cycle of poverty and famines every time, struck by the natural calamities. Railways were first introduced in 1850. The first train was run between Bombay and Thane and it brought about two major things. First is, it broke down all the cultural barriers and the geographical barriers that existed because it could now connect long distances. So that was the first thing, first revolutionary thing that happened with the railways. It fostered the commercialization of agriculture, but that negatively impacted the self-sufficiency of the villages because now, since agriculture was commercialized, the self-sufficiency of the villages was no more into existence and villages basically had to struggle for their food crops. The next was, the exports have expanded because of this. However, parallel to this, they started the inland waterways. Now, this inland waterways could not be a successful model because in every inland waterway, you had a parallel railway that was running and this railway was much more cost effective and much more cheaper as compared to the cost that the inland waterways had to bear, and slowly these waterways were removed. Again, in the aviation sector, Tata Airlines was first established in 1932 and it inaugurated the aviation sector in India. So, these were the changes in different sector. If we want to talk about in the summary, we can say under the agricultural sector, the productivity was very low and there was surplus of labor that existed in the agriculture. In the industries, it required modernization, expansion, diversification, capacity building, and that was not at all seen during the British period. The foreign trade was only meant to feed the industrial revolution in the Britain and the European nations. The infrastructure was basically hollowing out and it required upgradation, maintenance and expansion. Again, there was rampant poverty, social issues that were prevalent, and unemployment that was highly seen. So these were some of the challenges that we had in hand when we got independent. So on the eve of the independence, we had so many challenges in hand, and we had to struggle with those challenges. In the next sections, we will look after how we worked around and how the economics worked around with the establishment of planning commission and so on. So stay tuned with more lectures on economics. Have a very good day ahead.